Over the past few years, New York City has gone from a city with only a few or a handful or two of breweries in the five boroughs themselves to a city of many breweries with lots of smaller or even nano breweries opening up all over the five boroughs. One of those breweries is Transmitter Brewing in Long Island City. I was first introduced to them at the June New York City Homebrewers Guild meeting, where they presented the history of their brewery, what their philosophy is, and of course shared some of their great farmhouse ales. So after they finished their presentation, I introduced myself, told them about my blog, and asked if I'd be able to come down to the brewery for a visit. So finally, on Sunday, August 3rd, 2014, I took the 7 train, headed under the Pulaski Bridge, and headed to Transmitter Brewing. So sit back, grab a beer, and enjoy the tour of Transmitter Brewing.
It's a bit of a mess right now because we're not brewing and the usual stuff, hot liquor tank, mat on, foil kettle.
Right.
We have three fermenters right now, three barrel fermenters, and then this was one that we had from home brewing. So
and all the glycol's fed from up there all the way there.
Yeah. We have a couple of brights. We don't force carbonate out of them like a brewery would normally use, but we mix our sugar in there and then bottle out of there with a hand filler. Right now we're working on bottling a yeast experiment. So dirty yeast, same beer. We'll taste it today, or we'll taste it next week, and then as it carbonates over the next year, see what happens.
So this all comes from you having so many yeast strains already isolated, because not many breweries would do this many experiments like at once.
Right. Or ever. Right. There are some purchased yeast, you know, some of them are wine yeast, some of them are commercial examples of bread as well, and then many of them are cultured from bottles
and isolated.
And isolated. This one's, you know, that's from an apple and overgrown an apple orchard.
Where do you keep all the strains? You just keep propagating through these tests, or you have them stored in a fridge?
Right now, this is it. I'll take these and plate them and put them on slams to keep the mother culture, but probably do the same thing again. This is all primary bread. Primary bread experiment. I'd like to go back and do the same thing with saccharomyces and yeast first, and then put these over top to see what's good. That's a different way to use it. It'll be a different experiment. But these are now like probably 4 months old.
Same base beer, same exact beer, just split 30 ways, and then pitch. That's
for men. I mean, so even with you know, it being in such a 1 gallon scale, it still takes about 6 months to really show its true Brett character, right?
Oh yeah, we're gonna taste it over the next year.
Wow, beer today.
Primary Brett, you know, a whole different thing than secondary, so
right.
We'll see how.
There's some funky stuff.
Right.
Smells great. It
smells some crazy shit over here.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, you know, since it's just for us, we're just hand bottling it. You know, it's only us and our friends.
And you're only doing it in 750s, you're also doing in those small bottles.
500 milliliters, so six 500 milliliter bottles per batch. So two of them will get opened at the same day. There's an unsugared version. So we'll taste the still beer against the carbonated beer, and then we'll taste them, you know, every 3 months up to a year, and, you know, keep taking notes on the same beer, like, you know, continuation of those notes to see how the beer evolved.
That's great.
And then, you know, figure out how to mix them into our brewing. You know, the yeast that we use for our brewing day, you know, are, you know, we have 15 various strains of yeast right now that we keep in the cold room. That we, you know, we roll through to keep it fresh. Charles, right now, you know, there's 9 wine barrels, put the ones on top. The bottom barrels are 3 Caribbean rum barrels and 3 French brandy barrels. And we have various beers in most of them. We emptied a bunch of the wine out the last couple weeks, so those are getting ready to get rebrewed into. A couple of sours that'll be ready in a year and a half. We're trying to brew some stuff and let it bottle age for a while. You know, we haven't had the luxury of doing that. When we were homegrown, we really like to just let stuff sit for, you know, 3 to 6 months before we drank it. So just now we're starting to have some older beers that we can start releasing.
What are the main hops that you guys are using nowadays? It's like, you're focusing on Belgian beers, but you're brewing in America. So, like, which hops are you focusing on?
Whatever we can get our hands on.
I mean, there's, you know, around 30 strains of hops there. I mean, there's no, we use what the beer needs, really. We get our hands on some experimental varieties and use those once we, once we like them, or lots of Australian, New Zealand hops, and some, you know, some strong, fruity American citrus hops as well. Yeah, kind of whatever it takes. Orange peel, coriander, and hibiscus in it. Got like it'll clear, but it's got like a little bit of purple pink to it. We'll dry hop as well with it. I think it's with the biscuit.
In there,
what's that?
Still,
yeah, it's under attenuated.
In here, we've got a collaboration
here. Sorry, it's the end of the day here.
Local beekeeper Tom Wilkes has some hives in Long Island City, and this is 20 pounds of honey from Long Island City went into this beer, just starting to finish up. So the honey's a little slower to ferment than other sugars. So this will package and do like a collaboration thing with him, and he's gonna release it for a festival. It'll be fun.